Hi everyone, thanks for joining today's event. So this event really aims to provide you with an insight into some of the part-time, online and blended postgraduate study options and student experiences here at the University of Manchester. If you're considering postgraduate study in a part-time, online and or blended format, then you've come to the right place. We have a fantastic range of courses available to you here at the University of Manchester, courses which you are able to study part-time whilst continuing to work full-time, and courses which allow you to kind of study from anywhere in the world, but enable you to gain a qualification from a recognised institution here in Manchester. Making a choice, we think, as your recruitment advisors, about further study requires a lot of thought. So we hope you find this session insightful, and we hope this session is something which will help you to start thinking about your postgraduate study journey with the university. As your dedicated recruitment and course advisors, Jess and I are really here to support you as prospective students from this point onwards, and we're really happy to take any questions you have today and of course post event. So I'll kick off the introductions, I think. My name's Daisy. I am one of the recruitment course advisors here at the University of Manchester. My main role is to support prospective students during their decision-making journey. So I look after various different courses, courses which are in an online, part-time and blended format. So please feel free to kind of get in touch with me today or post-event. I'd be really happy to support you. Jess, I'm going to hand it over to you.
Thank you, Daisy. Hello, everyone. It's great to have you all here today and a great group of students here joining us. So I work in a very similar role to Daisy. I also am a course advisor here at the University of Manchester. We are joined by some current students from our postgraduate courses. Without further ado, I'll hand over to do some introductions while I sort my microphone out. So Chloe, would you like to introduce yourself first?
Sure, yeah, thank you, Jess. So my name's Chloe. I'm based in Singapore. I'm originally from Hong Kong and moved here for work. I did my BA in design, so I've been staying in that field in lighting and interior design. So now I'm studying the Masters in Real Estate based out here in Singapore with University of Manchester as a way to build that commercial awareness for the built environment.
That's great, Chloe. It's lovely to have you here. Obviously, you're based all the way over in Asia, so thank you so much for joining us a bit later on in the evening. These time differences are quite difficult to manage sometimes, aren't they? But we really appreciate you joining us. Maybe we'll hop over to Abnahav. Would you like to introduce yourself?
Sure. So, Chloe, I'm just a few hours away from you. I'm based in India, and professionally what I do is I'm a college counselor. So in simple words, I help students apply to colleges as well. And last year I found myself doing my own application applying to Manchester. So that was fun. And I'm currently enrolled in a master's course called Master of Leadership for Development. And even though I'm not really in the developmental sector, I've had a lot of background because my mother worked in it for a few years. And it's honestly, I was just looking to get inspired. I wanted to study something and just sort of broaden my horizon and just see if I can continue doing what I'm doing on a business front, on a work front, but also do something to kind of help, you know, the community and just drive some change on the education side as well. So that's why I enrolled in this course, and I'm at Manchester. So yeah, nice to be here.
Great, thank you very much, Abnahav, for joining us. It's wonderful to have you as one of our current students in general and on our panel discussion today. Well, Ali Reza, would you like to introduce yourself now?
Yes, sure. So hello everyone, nice to see you all, even it's beyond the internet. So my name is Ali Reza, and I'm a human geneticist and currently the fourth year PhD student of biomedical sciences and focusing on pharmacogenomics and at the Medical University of Białystok in Poland. So my main activities is using the bioinformatics tools and especially dedicated to pharmacogenomics to find out about the gene-drug interactions and working in the precision medicine area. So I also currently am a postgraduate students of the clinical bioinformatics in the University of Manchester. So I choose this course because I wanted to expand my knowledge in the field, and I was sure that this course and the course materials, of course, would be for me to perform my daily practice. So at your service.
Thank you very much. And you've actually come on to talk a bit there about our first question. So we're going to come on to about what initially attracted you to study this course. And we'll stick with you here, Ali Reza, because I know you have a lot more passion about the course than just what you said. Obviously, you're really passionate about the different bioinformatics tools that are available. You've gained the knowledge about these tools during your course. Why don't you touch a little bit more about this?
Yes, sure. Actually, I wanted to be in the course from the third unit. But you, Jessica, was the one just suggested me to start from the beginning. And now I'm really happy to just listen to you, because in the first unit, of course, as a human geneticist, I didn't expect to find out about more tools and more softwares which can be used in the bioinformatics area. And then when I started the course from the beginning, of course, from the unit one, I realized that this course would be very, very helpful for me. And I learned a lot of, you know, tools and softwares which can be used in my everyday work. So that's why, yeah, I'm really happy to choose this course from the beginning. It's very interesting for me. Of course, the first choice was the third unit, because I wanted to be, you know, a programmer writing scripts and, you know, a program developer or such a thing. But again, when I started from the beginning, that was very interesting. And now I'm obsessed with the materials. Yeah, it's very good.
I mean, that's definitely something, a great sentiment to have. You're obsessed with your learning, which is wonderful. And for those of you who perhaps are unsure about what it is that Ali Reza is referring to there, so the clinical bioinformatics program is 4 units long, and there are options to start throughout the course at different units. So the unit 3 course starts in November, so if anybody has any questions about the programming unit, that is, do message them in the chat box. But Ali Reza will be studying that very soon, which he's obviously very excited about, so that's great to hear. Chloe, we'll come on to you next. So what was it that initially attracted you to the real estate course? Very different sector, and I'm sure they're very similar but different motivations to what Ali Reza has touched on there.
Yeah, so in my day-to-day job in design, we kind of deal with these development projects. So to kind of understand the whole process, I felt like there was a commercial side that was lacking, but I didn't really have that prior knowledge in real estate per se. Like for finance, I'm not very good at finance modeling and economics. So I saw this course that was open to people from all different backgrounds. Actually, I saw someone on a virtual event like this who had a background in history also doing the real estate course. So I thought that was really interesting, and it felt less intimidating and more welcoming for different students with different backgrounds and work going on. And it just had a diverse range of subjects, so it was able to inspire me in what I want to do next in the real estate sector. So yeah, that was the main reason that I really felt, okay, it's quite a welcoming course, don't be afraid. And yes, yeah, very well covered as well in the different areas of real estate.
Yeah, I was just going to follow up on that and ask if there were any particular units which you found particularly inspiring when you were looking at the course.
Yeah, definitely more the finance and law of real estate. So those are the areas that's probably I don't know much about. So I was intrigued in those subjects, yeah.
Great, thank you very much for that. And finally, Abnahav, same question for yourself. Obviously, you're from an educational background working in a school. And what initially attracted you to the Leadership for Development course?
Yeah, I think for me, I was looking for distance learning courses because I just didn't want to leave work. And so I was just browsing and I was finding, you know, the typical MBAs and everything. And it just didn't seem exciting enough for me. And then when I came onto this course, it just suddenly, something sort of inside me was like, okay, this is interesting. I need to read through the course units and what this course is about. And because actually I'm not at a school, I have my own company, and I was kind of just starting that off. So I found the whole leadership component of it really useful. And then the development side of it was something I always wanted to do. I had done a lot of like volunteer work all throughout my childhood, even growing up, going through university and stuff. So it was something I wanted to explore. And I thought, you know, maybe this is the time to kind of embark on that journey through a master's. But yeah, it was exciting because I didn't find a course which was combining development and leadership together. And I think that really stood out to me. So, and I think just like Chloe, I was a bit confused at first because I was like, I don't come from a development background. But then through these, a lot of virtual webinars that, you know, Daisy helped us with, we realized that a lot of students were coming from very different backgrounds. And I just thought, it's okay to not have experience in that field and just start learning about it. So I think that was very nice as well, because there was an openness to just coming in and learning rather than being like, you have to have experience in this field and only then you can study this. So that was good for me.
That's wonderful. Thank you. It sounds these coming from the different backgrounds is obviously very interesting as well, because all of these courses have different entry requirements. So definitely get in touch with us if you're unsure about whether your background's suitable. But for the Master of Leadership and Leadership for Development and for the Real Estate, we're a lot more general than the Clinical Bioinformatics entry requirements.
Thank you, Jess. I was just going to follow up and then I froze, I think. So I think kind of support students and kind of really understand their backgrounds. So if you are unsure, like Chloe and Amhav were back in the day, about whether this course is the right course for them, speak to your dedicated course advisor. We're really here to help. Amhav was actually the first student I spoke to for the Masters of Leadership for Development. So I always remember you, Amhav, obviously, but you were the very first student I spoke to because it's a relatively new course. And I believe, well, you're on the course now, but we got to that point together because we had quite honest, transparent conversations about what it was that you're looking to do next, your eligibility, what you can bring to the table and what we can offer you, really. So I'm going to ask a question now. A question around kind of working full time and studying part time. Now, all of you guys are working full time and you're kind of juggling loads of different things. And one of those juggling balls is your studies. So, Abraham, I'm going to come to you first. How have you found, and I know you're quite relatively new to studying this course, but how have you found so far working full time and studying part time?
Yeah, it's been interesting. I mean, this is, like you said, it's still new for me. I think I'm in week 7 now, but I've gotten used to it. I think the biggest thing is to remember to be flexible. That's the biggest takeaway that I had, that every week is not going to be the same. I remember my first 3 weeks, I was studying a lot at night, and then last 2-3 weeks I've been so busy at work that everything that I'm doing is on the weekend. And that's also the nice thing about a master's online, that you have that level of flexibility. But I think time commitment can be a challenge, but you just need to plan ahead, just keep planning 7 days in advance, see how your work commitments look like in the coming week. I very often just browse through the course materials for the next week, just to understand, you know, how many readings there are, how many videos I need to see, how many assignments there are. So a little bit of planning helps, but also I think for a few weeks I was like, this is how it needs to be, I need to study in these hours. And then when that doesn't happen, you get frustrated. So you have to allow some flexibility and some planning, but I think I'm doing okay. I'm getting in the hang of it, and I think another takeaway that I had is just, you just have to really deal with, you know, stress, frustration. I've been doing a lot of meditation since I started the master's course, and things like that really help you just to sort of take a breather. And I think lastly, the professors and even just my peers and colleagues have been very supportive. We have like a master's WhatsApp group of our own where, you know, I was supposed to start a discussion post last week, but I've been really busy at work until November 1st. It's a busy time for me. So I requested one of them that is someone able to sort of take my spot, and they were willing to do it. And I swapped for them for week 8. So I think also just all the other peers and colleagues in the masters, everyone's very supportive and everyone understands that we're all leading busy lives in different time zones and with different commitments. So I think just having that open dialogue with your colleagues and your faculty just it's helped me a lot, and hopefully it stays that way.
Bab, thank you, Abnahab. There were some great pieces of advice there as well. So hopefully some of our prospective students can take those into consideration when they are hopefully enrolling on our programmes. Daisy?
Brilliant. Thanks, Jess. A little double act going on. Chloe, I'm going to come to you. So how have you found kind of working full time and studying part time? You've been on your course a little bit longer. So it would be great to hear from you.
Yeah, thank you, Daisy. I'm smiling so much because I can relate to what Abnahab was saying. You do take it week by week. It helps if you're quite an organized person anyway, but there's definitely its challenges because you're juggling a lot of different things. But saying that, you might have to cancel some weekend plans because you've got an assignment due, but once you've done the assignment, it's very rewarding, and then you feel like, oh, I've really achieved something. So those milestones do help to keep the momentum and motivation. Definitely keeping organized and just trying to juggle. But at the same time, it's short term, like it's a year or two or a few years of just putting your head down, and it's well worth it if you're really picking the subject you love, and time does fly. So as much as tricky as it is not impossible and not as difficult if you're enjoying what you're studying.
Thank you, Chloe. You're absolutely right. And I think a lot of our students really start to find their rhythm after a couple of weeks or months on the course. So you'll find really what works for you, what times work for you, and you'll find that rhythm and you'll go with that. And that's then what is ultimately how you become successful in your degree.
Sorry, everyone. I presume she's going to go on about, go on, Daisy, I think you're back.
Sorry, I'm not sure if you can hear me. I was just going on about the student support available to our students. So it is really second to none. You've got access to student support advisors. You've got access to your recruitment advisors who'd supported you to get onto the course, but we're still there to support you going forward. And you've got the academic teams who really want you guys to be successful in what you do, because ultimately they'll be successful in what they've produced in terms of course content. So you will be supported throughout your studies to kind of manage your time and kind of be successful. Alireza, I'm not sure if you are with us, but hopefully you are.
Yes.
Would you like to share your insights into how you found managing working full-time, studying part-time?
Exactly. So for me, the managing the time was the most challenging part of participation in this course, because as I mentioned before, I'm a last year PhD student, so I was engaged with tons of works, and I go into the lab in the morning. I know that, and I will come back in the afternoon. So it would be lots of works for my main PhD project. So all of my time are dedicated to my PhD. So I knew that if I want to engage in this course, I have to manage the time. And the only time I was free was my weekend. So again, it's all about the interest in my interests and the course materials, because I was very, very, hopeful that this course material would be helpful for me. So I was not annoying, actually, and I was just be happy to use my weekend to, work with the course and do the everything, the course activities and participation in the discussion forum and everything. And I actually divided my time and used my extra free time to use for this course. And then now it's okay, and it's working for me.
That's great, Alireza. Obviously, when you're working in more of a science-based role, and sometimes many of our students on the clinical bioinformatics course work in healthcare, things can be quite difficult, challenging, managing the shift patterns and things like that. So it's great that you found a way to manage your PhD and your additional studies as well. But I think as well, what the sort of general comment that's come out of this is when the course is the right program for you, when you've got that motivation to be studying, it doesn't seem as much as a challenge, as much of a hobby, if you will, something you're doing to improve your development and your personal commitments to things that will support your career. So that's great to hear from all of you on that respect. Chloe, I'm going to direct this one specifically to you. The reason I say this is because our real estate is traditionally a blended learning course. So with many of our blended learning courses, there is the opportunity to study either a conference or a workshop or a field trip, something sort of a bit more interactive alongside the online learning studies, which, for example, the Clinical Bioinformatics Programme is a fully online course, so that we don't offer those opportunities. Chloe, can you tell me a little bit more about your experience during the conferences? Obviously, these have been fully virtual for you due to obvious circumstances.
Yeah. No, they've been great, actually. They've been kind of like a term break refresh where everyone comes together and you see your tutors, your cohort on video. So it does feel almost like a lecture hall, even though it's virtual. And then we do get some really interesting industry speakers. And I guess virtually also helps with industry speakers from all over the world as well. So they've been great, almost milestones to catch up with everyone and again build that study momentum and get inspired afterwards.
That's great. And we recently had the September conference as well. What was your favourite part of the conference that's just taken place?
Yeah, definitely the industry speakers, because it really gives you a live example of what you can get out of this course and how it relates to the different job roles out there. But yeah, so I think we've got some really interesting industry speakers from very well-known companies. So that was very inspiring.
And I imagine that also a great opportunity to network with other people on your course and the academics. Have you built any good relationships through the conferences at all?
Yeah, definitely. So those opportunities, we have some group discussions as well, and some group activities and quizzes. So in that way, we got to network in a formal and informal setting as well.
Thanks, Chloe. That's great. Now, having Alireza, you study purely online courses. So what I would like to ask you both now, Abnehav, I'll ask you first, is what are the benefits of studying online for you? And can you tell our audience about the online platform that you learn from and use kind of while studying? Is that okay?
So the most advantages of this online course is that because it's fully online, you can participate in the course from anywhere, anytime. And they use mostly Zoom and for the lectures, and the Blackboard for the course materials, and of course the Slack recently for the discussion forum. So all of these applications are available everywhere. So you can join for your course materials, even for the lectures, they will record everything. So if you lost the live lecture, you can participate later and you can actually access to them later and use the course materials and all the lectures. So the most advantage, as I mentioned, is the accessibility to all of these course materials from everywhere. This is the main advantage.
Yeah, I think the first part of that question for me, just reason of doing this online is just so that I could carry on with my work and not quit that. And I also think, for me, it was about learning than networking so much on campus and getting that exposure, because I feel like I've studied overseas and had that. And at this point in my career, for me, the most important thing was the actual learning and the content part of it, which I thought I can receive online as well. I don't need to be on campus. So that made online education easier. And I think the biggest thing for me so far in our course is that we haven't really had live lectures. I mean, we've had some discussions where it's, a few of them, a few students join. Some of them, if you can't join, it's not a problem. It's not really a part of the course. It's not being graded. It's not a real lecture. It's more of just can we all just connect once a month, once in 3 weeks, and just keep in touch? It's almost like, let's try and make it an on-campus experience without being on campus. But the Blackboard has been very useful. That's where we do all our discussion posts, and then PebblePad where all the assignments go. And so far in the course, what I've seen, we have every week there's a section laid out, and there's the important stuff there. And then the professors will tell you which are like the recommended academic journals that you need to read through, which are the ones which are optional. Some of them have videos in them, 10 minutes long, 20 minutes long. So it's interesting. I think that also for a student who enjoys videos more than reading, or vice versa, both those options are there. And I think the biggest advantage is you can just do it in your own time. Like I mentioned, my first few weeks, I was doing a lot on weekdays. And then the following weeks, it's been mostly on the weekend. And I think someone in the questions asked that question as well, specific to leadership for development, that if there's a difference in time zone. And not really. I mean, we all do our things in our own time. And when we do fixed calls, we try and make sure that those calls are being set up so that everyone can join, but they're not necessary calls. I'll also give you another insight into that. The students have created a different WhatsApp group, and two or three times we've connected without the professor in just sets of twos and threes, so that, you know, someone can connect at a time, and it works for another person who's sitting in Australia or Tanzania. We can connect, and everyone doesn't have to be on that call. So that's just so that we keep each other stimulated, but that's not something that's necessary. So time zone is really not an issue. There's a lot of flexibility.
Great, thank you very much. So kind of based on this, obviously we're talking about we've touched briefly here on the sort of time difference elements, and we've had a few questions about this in the chat. My next question is going to be about the diversity of the cohort studying our online courses. So when I say diversity as well, I guess we can look at that in a few different ways. So obviously we've got the international element, it's a real global cohort, you have students from all over the world studying, whereas we also have the side of it where it's a completely diverse set of working professionals. So we have people in completely different backgrounds, coming from different industries. So I guess, Chloe, first I'll come to you about the first part of that. How have you found studying with students from all over the world in terms of time difference, but also in terms of their experience in different markets? How has that experience been?
Yeah, for time difference wise, as Alireza mentioned, having a WhatsApp group, it makes everyone connect. And you do have students also from this part of the world and this time zone, so they're able to kind of communicate and workshop with you, and you're always having such a diverse input into the discussions. So real estate obviously has different urban settings in all these different cities in the world, so everyone has their insight and input in that way, so it definitely makes discussions a lot more interesting. Yeah, it just makes the world feel smaller in a way when you have things like WhatsApp where you can just communicate and ask them, oh, what's it like? How's it different in your setting? And you can ask those questions, which is really good.
That's wonderful, Chloe. Thank you. And Abnehab, same sort of question. How have you found the diversity of your cohort? How has this been, whether be it from different countries or different backgrounds?
Yeah, it's been very interesting. I think, like you mentioned, it's not just about people coming from different parts of the world, there's different industries. And we actually had a Zoom meeting yesterday or 2 days ago with our professor, and we were just discussing these things about how so far it's just been 6 weeks and all our perspectives about development have evolved so much, because we all came from different parts of development. And I had done some work with nonprofits versus someone else has done work with the UN and World Bank, and we're all talking about issues from a very different perspective. Someone is saying that we've worked in a space where we're always struggling for funding, and then someone else is saying we're struggling where to invest that funding. We have so much money sitting in the organization, we don't know where to put it. And so even just within the field of development and leadership, everyone's coming from such different areas that it opens up a lot of perspectives for you and ideas. So I think that's been great. It's actually made me think about if I actually want a career switch or not. It's in 6 weeks, I've been thinking about that as well, because I always, the way I've seen development in India is there's a lot of nonprofit work and people are not making a ton of money. But now I'm seeing it from a perspective of where you can make money and also cause change, and looking at it from that perspective and questioning myself that, you know, does this make sense? Do you, would you want to consider this? So far, I mean, it's been like transformational, and I don't think that would be possible if it wasn't for such a diverse cohort.
Yeah. That's really interesting as well. We've just added a new level to the diversity there of different careers that you can go into. And Alireza, a bit different with your course as well, because obviously, although we still have that diversity, your cohort particularly, which I worked very closely with last year, was such an international cohort. I remember during your offer holder event, we went round the room and we had people from all over the world, didn't we? That must make for such a diverse learning experience as well. How have you found that experience?
So I think the most precious property for every researcher is finding someone new in his field or in the other field which can be helpful for his research. So especially for such a online course, we can have different people with different backgrounds, and it's actually a multidisciplinary field. So we can use the, you know, everybody's specialty in our research maybe later, but as I've said before, it's not just about this course. We can continue our connection to other students beyond the course, and after the course we can just join to each other in different way, and we can collaborate each other. So for me, this part was very, very interesting and, you know, fascinating, but it was very good.
But I think as well with your course particularly as well, you have two sort of key students who start to come in. You have people with a science background and people with more of a healthcare background, and I think in different units as well, it's really a sharing of knowledge. We do say it's more, you build a community of knowledge for those who can, maybe in unit one you might have had a stronger background, whereas in unit three there might be someone who helps you during your course. So that diversity is so important for a course such as yours as well. So I hope you find that sharing during your third unit.
Sure, it was helpful. Yeah, exactly. The main point is, as you mentioned, is just we all of us have different backgrounds, and we have our strengths in different units. And for example, in unit two, so it's a kind of an informatics and less bioinformatics. So for me, it's a little unknown, but I can use the other people's and other students who actually are working currently in the healthcare system. So I can use their knowledge, especially in the discussion forum, to gain more experiences in the field. And it would be extremely, extremely helpful for my, maybe not right now, but for the future, it would be very helpful, because I don't know where my career just, you know, to take me.
Thanks, Alireza, for that insight. That's great. And also thanks, Chloe, Abhinav. It's brilliant that you're all kind of on the same page with how you feel about being part of such a global community. Chloe, I'd like to come to you next. So what aspects of your course have you enjoyed so far? Kind of what's been your favourite part?
It probably kind of links with the diversity. Just adding to the diversity also with the tutors, they also come from different backgrounds, so they have a different perspective on real estate to teach us, and I've really enjoyed the resources that's available, and of course the library as well. You've got so much you can look into and research. It's just kind of endless information you can keep learning from, so that's probably my favourite part, yeah.
Thanks, Chloe. Yeah, I think it is endless. There's almost too much, because you could study forever, I think, once you get into a topic. I remember when I was doing my undergraduate degree, slightly different to a master's, but once you started to get into something, you kind of didn't want to stop. So, Abhinav, what have you enjoyed so far?
I think for me, it's just been, it's made me think a lot so far. And I feel like whatever I knew about development was so, so, so limited. And now it's just being expanded in a lot of ways, because whatever I saw from a nonprofit side, I'm now starting to realize what how much of an impact nonprofit has and which are the bigger stakeholders perhaps in development, and just different concepts around, you know, we were studying something around China becoming a much more developed country slowly as their economy is boosted, but that's not necessarily the case for other countries. So can we pin down economics and say that this is what changes the world and causes development? So there's just a lot of interesting things to think about from the whole aspect of development. But yeah, we're going to end our first unit, I think, in 3 weeks. I'm also looking forward to the next unit now because that's, I think, solely on leadership. So I'm also excited about that. The first unit has been about development, so it's all very new. But I think as we get into leadership as well, that's going to be something where I've had experience. I'll be able to relate to it more. But it's just opened up a lot of perspectives and just given me a lot of idea on insights on various different things which I didn't have before. And very engaging content. That's the thing. That's what you guys were discussing. That the content is so good that that's the best thing about it, I think, because just being home, being alone and sort of studying on your own at home is not always the easiest. And it's not always easy to keep that motivation level high. But when the content is engaging enough, you keep coming back to it. So that's been very useful as well.
That's great to hear as well. It's fabulous to hear that it's so comprehensive by the sounds of it. It's got all the different elements that you need on it. But we've got a few final questions now. So I think we'd like to just finally touch on the future, looking forward into where this course might take you. Alireza, have you thought any more about where, after completing your PhD and after completing the postgraduate certificate, where you might go to next with the skills you've gained from this course?
Exactly. So what I'm learning here from this course is the exact works which I'm using at my daily practice. So even in my during my PhD or after this, in my working in, I don't know, it would be the academic section or it would be in a company, I don't know, but I'm sure that 100% sure that it would be my daily work. So what I'm learning here absolutely will, you know, affect my future works. So yes, it's very good.
Thank you. And Chloe, Chloe, we've all touched on this already a bit, haven't we, about your next steps after the programme. But I'm not sure if there's anything more specific you wanted to comment on here.
Yeah, I guess I haven't got a focus yet, but I'm definitely much more confident with the skills I've learned to kind of go into talk about real estate and what it's about, basically, but also the skills from essay writing or reading comprehensively, those kind of analytical skills. I've also felt like since my BA and master's, it's been like 5-6 years. So to pick that back up again, it was nice to feel like, oh, okay, I haven't lost those skills completely. I can build it back up after a few years.
Definitely, there's always time to return back to education, return back to that professional development. And Abneha, finally, is there anywhere where you can see your career going in the future?
Yeah, like I mentioned, I've been completely thinking about a career switch as well. And I still have, you know, I've just started off. I still have 2 years to go until the master's finishes. So I know my plans and thoughts are going to keep evolving. But I'm kind of open. I'm open to a complete change. Initially, when I came in, my goal was to see if I can carry on doing my business, but also maybe build a small foundation on the side. So that's still something that's there in my mind. And the other thing is, I feel just the leadership component of the master's, hopefully that plays into what I'm doing anyway. So yeah, I'm just looking forward to how things go. Just gonna go with the flow and keep all options open.
One thing I just want to say, I'm going to have there, and obviously this is relevant for Chloe and Alireza as well, but I am really excited to see where you go next. I think you are all evolving as students, and you'll continue to do so until the end and post-degree. You've gone into this kind of really up for a challenge, and it's been challenging, and it will continue to be challenging, but I think what the aim of our masters in kind of all of our portfolio, the aim is to really challenge you as individuals, but that challenge will ultimately pay off in the long term in terms of your professional and personal development.
Chloe, how have you found your assessments on the real estate course?
So for the course, there's different assignments and they have different weighting for each module as well. So some of them might be more towards your expertise, like some calculations, some professional reports for valuing a property, for example. And then we also do a lot of group work, which is always a lot of fun. And that's a great way to get to know your cohort as well. So there's a real variety, but also an insight into probably some day-to-day responsibilities you have in real estate jobs. And for real estate-wise, the tutors with the feedback, we always kind of just reach out sometimes and they're really happy to jump on a call and then just clarify them what they mean. Because yeah, sometimes they can be misunderstood. So they're always a call away, which is really helpful.
Just about kind of one piece of advice you guys would give prospective students who are considering postgraduate study. So what would you have wanted to know prior to joining? So Abnehav, I'll come to you first.
Yeah, I think for me the biggest thing was what the content would look like and just evaluating. I think you must evaluate, is this going to help you and why are you doing it, right? What's the purpose? Is it to get a salary increment? Is it to change your industry? Is it to just learn? For me, it was a lot of those things, but it was mostly to just learn. It was mostly to just sort of learn something that inspires me. But for somebody else, it wasn't that. So I think just understanding why do you really want to enroll in the master's helps. And that why keeps coming back to you, because you might go through really busy weeks at work and you're wondering, you know, why did I enroll in this master's? And that's when you have to sort of remember that's why. So I think that's important. Don't just, you know, apply and just enroll in it. Do think carefully about why do you really want to do it? And I think the second thing, biggest aspect for me was just understanding, which you helped me a lot with, Daisy, is that the time commitment of it and how is it structured? I think everyone who's prospective students, whoever's watching right now, you guys can see that all three of us have very different models in terms of how we learn. So there are live lectures, there are recorded lectures and different forms of learning. So just understanding whatever course you're looking at, how exactly it's being taught and how well does that fit with your schedule and your preferences. I think that's the biggest one for me.
Thanks, Abnehav. And you're absolutely right. You've got to be honest with yourself before embarking on this journey. Like you said, kind of really almost writing down why it is you're doing this and having that conversation with us as your recruitment support advisors. That again is super important, because we will be honest back. We will tell you how it is and we'll tell you whether or not this is. I'd like to say thank you very much for joining. It's great to have you all from various parts of the globe in one virtual room, and it's great to hear you all enjoying yourselves on your courses so far. So just to kind of finish off, Jess and I are your kind of recruitment advisors here at the University of Manchester. We look after a whole range of part-time, online and blended courses. Please, if you are interested, get in touch with us by emailing studyonline@manchester.ac.uk. We will support you in kind of taking your next steps with the University of Manchester whenever that waits a little bit, but we will be here to support you whenever the time's right for you. Jess, I don't know if there's anything you'd like to say to finish off.
No, everything you've said has been fab, but I think we'll leave it there for now. Obviously, you've got our contact information and we have included a short survey for you to please fill in the chat box at the moment. But thank you very much for joining us today, everybody. It's been great. And thank you to all our panellists again, and have a wonderful rest of your day wherever you're joining us from. Thank you.